Dear precious Heavenly Father, I pray that you just bless this offering tonight, Lord. I pray that you bless those that give and those that don't give, Lord, because it's more than just the money, Lord. It's about the heart, Lord. I pray that you bless the heart, Lord. I pray that you bless all those that attend and those that don't attend. I pray that you bless those that are ill and those that are healthy, Lord. Young, old, it doesn't matter, Lord. I pray that you bless Heather tonight as she preaches your message, Lord. I pray that you anoint her and give her your gift, Lord, and let it be you and your grace, Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray.
Kiss the bride neck.
Yeah. Hold on, we're gonna get there.
We got a bride, we got a groom.
Uh-oh.
Okay, so now it's the band. Okay, so we tried so hard to make the church look nice, but obviously there's still video games in our church. Cool. Pastor Bob decided to wear the exact same thing as Nick that day. And then he forgot to tell us to kiss. So that's my reaction to that. And that, this is our ring fingers. So that we can. We got bum balls after I put that on. And then the limo ride got a little crazy. I don't even know what Nick's drinking. That's just terrible.
That was water.
That's water.
That was water.
Okay. So everything in a wedding is always one crack with me. But it's still good. It's still a blessing. And everything, you know, it always works out in the end, hopefully. So let's start in Genesis 2, 18-24. If anybody's got any Bibles, I will definitely give you time to run back there and get one if your heart desires. But let's start where God gives Adam his bride. Hey, Brett, you want to read it for me?
Sure
can. Thank you.
The Lord God said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him." Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the wild animals and all the birds in the sky. He brought them to the man to see what he would name them. And whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave names to all the livestock, the birds in the sky, and all the wild animals. But for Adam, no suitable helper was found. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with the flesh. But the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. The man said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. That is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to the wife, and they become one flesh."
There you go. You got a wife. Now you get why they call it a pure pain in my side. Okay. So we have a husband and we have a wife. So now we have a bride and we have a groom. So now we're going to go into Ephesians 5. I'm going to read 22-24 as the wife. So wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now as the church submit to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. So as my husband, Nick, will you please read Ephesians 5, 25-32 for me?
Sure can.
Let me get to it.
Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having a spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. So husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself.
Picture, Nick loving himself.
I don't know why that came up. Okay, so the definition of a bride, I kind of went out of order. A bride is a woman about to be married. And the definition of a bridegroom is a man about to be married. But I didn't know it was a bridegroom. So first I Googled groom. It sounds a little weird, but it does have a point, I promise. So the definition of a groom is a person who takes care of horses and stables. Don't worry about that part. To take care of the appearance of, to make neat and trim, to remove dirt and parasites from the skin, and to prepare as for a specific position or purpose. So remember that. All of this has a reason, I promise, but you won't get it till the end. Okay, so we know what a husband is, we know what a wife is, we know how we're supposed to treat each other, yada, yada, yada. Okay, so now we're going to go into Hosea It's in the Old Testament. Now, back then, Israel was not listening to God. They weren't thanking him for anything. They were worshiping other gods. They were taking advantage of all of the things that God was giving them. They wanted the finer things in life. All their crops were good. Everything was perfect, but they weren't thanking the Lord. They weren't giving him any of the praise for all this stuff. But Hosea was a man after God's heart, and God had Hosea preaching in Israel to all the Israelites, letting them know, hey, if you don't listen, if you don't start worshiping God, this is what's going to happen. So he just kept warning them and warning them, you know, watch out, you know, the wrath of God is coming, and he will take things away. So God had Hosea marry a woman named Gomer. So now we got a husband and a wife. I'm going somewhere, I promise. It says, when the Lord began to speak to Hosea, the Lord said to him, go take to yourself an adulterous wife and children of unfaithfulness, because the land is guilty of the vilest adultery and departing from the Lord. So even though God knew that Gomer was going to cheat on Hosea, and Hosea knew it because God told him, he still married her, he still loved her, they still had children. But what God was doing was letting Hosea know how he felt about his land, about Israel. So Gomer's going to, obviously she'll cheat on Hosea. She goes after men with the jewels, with they can give her this, they can give her that. And it's exactly what Israel was doing to God. They can give me this. I can get this from this praying to this God. I can do this and this and this, but I don't need you, you know. So I'm going to read in the second chapter. Now this is Hosea speaking through God. Rebuke your mother, rebuke her, for she is not my wife, and I am not her husband. Let her remove the adulterous look from her face and the unfaithfulness from between her breasts. Otherwise, I will strip her naked and make her as bare as on the day she was born. I will make her like a desert, turn her into a parched land, and slay her with thirst. I will not show my love to her children because they are the children of adultery. Their mother has been unfaithful and has conceived them in disgrace. So this is God warning Israel, you know, I will take things away. I am going to make your land dry. Everything is not going to be good if you do not start worshiping me. And again, you have to remember, Hosea is going through the exact same thing with his wife. You know, he's telling, you know, letting her know, it ain't good. You got to come back to me. She said, I will go after my lovers who give me my food and my water, my wool, and my linen, my oil, and my drink. Therefore, I will block her path with thorn bushes. I will wall her in so that she cannot find her way. She will chase after her lovers, but not catch them. She will look for them, but not find them. So, obviously she's saying, I want what I want. Israel's saying, I want what I want. Remember, you got two different things going on, two different stories, but it's, you know, still in the same. Then she will say, I will go back to my husband as at first, for then I was better off than now. She has not acknowledged that I was the one who gave her the grain, the new wine, and oil, who lavished on her the silver and gold, which they used for Baal. Did I say it right, Robbie? Baal.
Baal, yeah.
What is it?
Baal.
Baal? It's a god that they worship. So therefore, I will take away my grain when it ripens. So this is God, here he goes. He's telling them this is what's going to happen. Therefore, I will take away my grain when it ripens and my new wine when it is ready. I will take back my wool and my linen intended to cover her nakedness. So now I will expose her lewdness before the eyes of her lovers. No one will take her out of my hands. I will stop all celebrations, her yearly festivals, her new moons, her Sabbath day, all her appointed feasts. I will ruin her vines and her fig trees, which she said were her pay from her lovers. I will make them a thicket, and wild animals will devour them. I will punish her for the days she burned incense to the veils, bows, something. She decked herself with rings and jewelry and went after her lovers, but me she forgot, declares the Lord. So, that's it. It's all taken away. God, you know, it's a lot of my God. He's saying, this is my stuff. I'm taking it away. You know, it's all gone. And that's exactly what happened with Gomer, with Hosea. Everything was gone. She had nothing left. So here's where the love story happens. It's good stuff. It's very romantic. Therefore, I am now going to allure her. I will lead her into the desert and speak tenderly to her. There I will give her back her vineyards. I will make the valley of Achor a door of hope. There she will sing as in the days of her youth, as in the days she came up out of Egypt. In that day, declares the Lord, you will call me my husband. You will no longer call me my master. I will remove the name of the Baals from her lips. No longer will their names be invoked. In that day, I will make a covenant from them with the beasts of the field and the birds of the air and the creatures that move along the ground. Bow and sword and battle I will abolish from the land, so that all may lie down in safety. I will betroth you to me forever, ever. I will betroth you in righteousness and justice, in love and compassion. I will betroth you in faithfulness, and you will acknowledge the Lord. In that day I will respond, declares the Lord. I will respond to the skies, and they will respond to the earth, and the earth will respond to the grain, and the new wine and oil, and they will respond to Jezreel. I will plant her for myself in the land. I will show my love to the one I called not my loved one. I will say to those called not my people, you are my people, and they will say you are my God. So in the end, he wooed them all back. He took everything away, and he got them all back. I don't know how many times have you guys heard Robbie and Deanna say, sometimes things have to die before the Lord can bring them back up. So this is a good example of that. Sometimes some things in our life that we want, that we think is just so great, and this is going to make me a better person, and I know this is what God wants for me, it might not be, and he's just going to let that, who knows, you know, one day I might lose my voice, and I'll be able to sing for God anymore, but he's going to rise me back up in something new that's for him again. So, about Hosea and Gomer, it ends good too. The Lord said to me, to Hosea, go show your love to your wife again, though she is loved by another and is an adulteress. Love her as the Lord loves the Israelites. So he's saying, take her back, get her back, though they turn to other gods and love the sacred brazen case. So I bought her for 15 shekels of silver and about a homer and a little bit of barley. Then I told her, you are to live with me many days. You must not be a prostitute or be inmate with any man, and I will live with you. So he got her back. He got back his love. He wooed her back in, and they can start fresh. They can start over. So that is what God wants from us. Now back to the bride and groom thing, and this is my example of a husband and wife. The church, not broken chains, but the church as a whole, we are the bride. And Christ is the bridegroom, waiting for us at the altar. Now, remember what I said, what a groom was. Now that we know Christ is the bridegroom, let me go back. We're going to skip the horse and stable part. You ready? To take care of the appearance of, to make neat and trim, to remove dirt and parasites from the skin, and to prepare us for a specific position or purpose. Make sense? Did it click? God is good. He's going to clean us. He's going to shine us all up to get us ready for that marriage with him. Amen. That is so good. It's so neat, all the words he made up. Isn't it? They all put it together. It's cool. That's good. So, let's go back. We're going to read Ephesians again. And this time, I don't want you to think of a woman and a man as the bride and the groom, as a husband and wife. I want you to hear it as the church and as Christ being the bridegroom. Hey, Brett, would you read all that for me, please?
Sure. Wives, submit yourself to your own husbands as you do to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything.
Keep going, please.
Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having a spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. So husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself.
Good. There, does that make sense now? So it's not only God telling us how we should treat our husbands or our wives, but it's the main big example is how we as the church should look at Christ as our bridegroom that is coming back for us and he wants us. And now we are going to go to Revelations 19. 7-9. Okay. Get ready to press play, Robbie. I gotta do something a little crazy. Okay, let us rejoice and be glad and give him glory, for the wedding of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready, fine linen, bright and clean. was given to her to wear. Then the angel said to me, write, blessed are those who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb. And he added, these are the true words of God. So, when he comes back, we will get our big wedding reception and our big party because we were ready for Christ. So, go ahead and press play, please. Maybe.
Soda. Coffee. Go ahead.
Okay.
That's our reception.
Go, Robbie, you go.
Amen.
Amen.